writes heavily with nuisance and the principle in Rylance and Fletcher. In relation to nuisance and Rylance, both topics deal with liability imposed on an owner of land in relation to tax or omissions done by them which affects the land of another. Arising occupies liability, this topic deals with the liability imposed on the owner of land, or in this case, the person who sufficiently controls land, and whatever acts and omissions that are effectuated in that land itself. There are three main areas that we need to focus on when we consider occupier's liability. Firstly, we need to determine who an occupier is in relation to this topic. Now, in Harris and Birkenhead, it was noted that an occupier is a person who controls to a sufficient degree the land in question. Now, if you look at some of the literature of Headley in Tort, what he considers as an occupier is a person who has legal control and not actual control. That is a distinct difference in this, so have a look at it in the case summaries. There are a few other considerations that we'll need to look at before we move on. Firstly, in Bailey and Ames, it was noted that the owner must be aware of the danger in order for him to be liable. Now, this is an obvious conclusion, but what we must take out of this judgment, or from what was held, is that the occupier need not be liable for things that he is not aware of. It might have been a danger that has come into play while he was not there, or rather, once someone else had taken over. So have a look at Bailey and Ames along with Meat and E. Blacon. Before we move on, we need to consider several other aspects as well, primarily of which is the fact that if the owner is unaware of whatever danger that lies with his property, he cannot be held liable. As was held in Bailey and Ames, an important factor to denote, and going on to our next segment in the topic, is that occupier's liability is based on two specific groups of people. On the one hand, you have the visitor, a person who has come into the property with permission. And on the other hand, you have the trespasser, a person who has come without permission. Both types of individuals are important to consider, and as such are governed by two individual acts. For instance, a visitor is considered under the Occupier's Liability Act of 1957, and a trespasser is considered under the Occupier's Liability Act of 1984. We'll first look at the visitor. A visitor, according to Section 2.1 of the Occupier's Liability Act of 1957, is someone who has implied or expressed permission to be on the premises. It is important to note that this permission or this authority must be provided by the occupier. Now, while there is no specific definition provided for an occupier in the Act itself, it is wise to consider that which was stated in Harris and Birkenhead as in a person who has sufficient control of the property. However, it does not mean that this liability extends to people who simply have a right of way. As in McGowan and Northern Ireland, it's there in the case summaries, have a look at it. Because he's not considered as a visitor, and the defendant, occupier, has no positive duty towards such a claimant. But on the other hand, children are considered to have an implied permission granted to them, as in Edwards and Railway Executive. This is, quite frankly, a policy initiative to make sure that there is some form of redress for children. There is case law to suggest that occupiers have gone to great lengths to make sure that permission is not granted, and moreover, to indicate to anyone passing by or anyone who is attempting to come into the property itself that there is no permission being given. And while this is okay, Lowry and Walker states that they must do enough to provide information or indicate that there is no permission granted, but not go over. Have a look at Walker. It's a very interesting case. It's available in your case summaries as well. It related to an extreme example of what an occupier, or if an occupier in this case, went remains, the permission exists only to the extent to which it is granted. Now, there are several examples of this in case law, one of which is hardly a democratic answer. But in a very simplistic manner, if you invite a person into a living room of a house, and this person goes on to the rooftop or to a balcony, it might be the case that the permission only exists in that one vicinity or the living room itself, and not the balcony or the dining room, and so on and so forth. So if something were to occur in any place outside of the living room, it might be the case that an occupier or a defendant occupier is not liable. However, all of this depends on a case-by-case basis. The question that arises quite often in examination situations and tutorials is how occupiers are liable in relation to people that they have given permission to do something in the household. For instance, a professional, an electrician, or plumber. Now, there are two schools of thought. Firstly, when it comes to an independent contractor, if it relates to a job which is normal in the context of perhaps plumbing or electrical work, then the occupier may be liable as held in Woodward and Hastings. Now, while normal is a qualitative and quite ambiguous term to use, what it refers to is, does the occupier know what the person who is coming in is actually doing? Does he have at least some semblance to determine whether the job that's been done or what was done by the professional is correct or when it works? For instance, if a plumber comes in to fix a tap, when it breaks or if it's not functioning properly, you as the occupier would be aware that it does not work. On the other hand, as in Hazelin and Law, if work is technical in nature, the occupier may not be liable. Now, in this specific case, it related to an elevator being fixed or an elevator being made. So, in the process of the repair occurring, the occupier was not meant or he ought to have not known whether what the professional or what the technician was doing was correct or not. So therefore, since the work itself was technical in nature, the defendant occupier was not held liable. Have a look at both these cases. It provides a very deep contrast into when a defendant occupier is held liable or not. The whole notion of responsibility being imposed on the occupier, or rather the liability being imposed on a defendant occupier, is that there should be sufficient warning provided to a visitor. In Horton and Jackson, it was stated that there is no need to be safe, as if the environment need not be safe, as long as sufficient warning has been given to a visitor. But the risk itself need not be obvious either, as in Harvey and National Trust. According to the Occupiers Liability Act of 1957, a successful party, as in attainment, is eligible to receive damages for injury or death, as well as property. Now, it's an important aspect of the Occupiers Liability Act of 1957 that damages are afforded for damage or loss of property. And you'll understand why when we have a look at trespasses. The final section that we'll be looking at in relation to occupiers liability is what is afforded for a trespasser, as in the Occupiers Liability Act of 1984. Now, the Act itself does not outline a trespasser outright. Rather, it stipulates the liability imposed on the defendant for anyone other than a visitor. The notion of a trespasser having some form of rights in relation to a defendant occupier seems quite trivial to a lot of students, but how we must look at it is not in the context of a thief or a robber. Rather, we must consider the trespasser as a person who has perhaps received permission to a certain degree and then exceeded it either knowingly or unknowingly. Now, what's important to note is, as we saw in relation to a visitor, as stated in the Occupiers Liability Act of 1957, damages are afforded to a claimant in relation to injury, death, as well as property loss. However, in relation to a trespasser or a person who is classified as a trespasser, damages are only available for personal injury and death, but not source of property. Now, how do we determine what sort of liability will be imposed on the claimant occupier? Well, in Tomlinson and Colberton, the requirement of liability to be imposed was threefold. Firstly, the defendant occupier must have known of the danger in some way, shape, or form. Secondly, the defendant should have believed that the claimant would come into the danger. And finally, the defendant was expected to provide protection. Occupier's liability as a whole is a topic which enriches an answer of a student. Be it negligence or otherwise, it's a topic which will most often come coupled with another. In any event, it is important to note the specific acts, as in the Occupier's Liability Act of 1957 and the Occupier's Liability Act of 1984, simply because next to defamation,